Jesus, here we are. Here we are, Lord. We're your servants, Jesus. Called by your name, Jesus. We hear the call, Lord. We rise up and shake ourselves, Lord. We're running after you. We're laying aside the things that have held us back so many years. We're running after you with all of our heart. Lord, we may be considered radicals by our peers. Those around us may not understand, but Lord, we've been touched by a greater thing. We've been touched by a greater thing, and we can't settle for yesterday. We can't settle for less than your glory, Lord. We can't settle for less than you, Jesus. We want you, Jesus. We want you in our churches, Lord. We want you in our lives, Lord. We want you in our families, Lord Jesus. God, we want to see this world shake with your glory. God, in modern times, we want to see you, Lord, do what we know you're capable of. God, we want to see the dead raised, not for the glory of men, but so that all may fear and tremble and know that you are the Lord God Almighty. God, we want to see the men of our own government tremble with fear before the Lord God. Because you are the only God. You're the only true God. You're the only living God. You're not a monument. You're not a statue. But you're a living God. You have fire in your eyes. You have passion in your voice. And we long for you, Jesus. We long for you, Lord. Oh, oh, Jesus. 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 There's some people in this building tonight. The Lord says you've come here expecting the Lord to touch you, but you don't quite know what you're asking for. Because if you'll make yourself available to God, God will change your life in such a way you won't recognize yourself. And the Lord says it may cost you some friends, and it may cost you some reputation. But you must make up your mind this day whom you'll serve. Will you serve your reputation and your good name, or will you serve the Lord God Almighty? And you've not been brought here just to experience a series of services. The Lord said, I brought you here divinely to shake up your world, and to take you out of your comfort zone, and to take you out of complacency. The Lord said, you've asked me for great things, but the great things have to begin, the Lord says, in your life. Because I have to shake all the things that are comforting away from you so that you'll trust me, says the Lord. So that you'll rely on me, says the Lord. So that you'll depend on me. Because your dependence has been on your capabilities and on your abilities to do the things you do. But the Lord says, you'll put no gods before me. That includes yourself. You will wait upon the Lord and trust in him, and him only will you trust. And the Lord says, if you'll allow me, I'll change you. I'll change you. And I'll fulfill the call that I've put into your life. But only if you allow me to shake your life and shake the things loose that you're holding on to as security. Oh, we hear you, Lord. We hear you, Lord. We hear you, Lord. We hear you, Lord. This is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you. All I have within me, I give you praise, I give you praise. All that I adore is in you. I
give you my soul. I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm away. Lord, have your way in me. Oh.
Sing it, choir. This is my desire.
This is my desire.
Come on, lay your heart before the Lord tonight to honor you.
Honor.
Take down all the fences and just allow the Holy Spirit to begin to move in your life.
Honor.
Lord, with all my heart, I worship you. Sing to him. Surrender to him. All I have within me. Sing it, church.
All I have.
I give you praise.
I give you praise.
All that I adore.
All that I adore.
Is in you.
Is in you.
Lord, I give you my heart.
Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul.
Sing it, church, to the Lord. I give you my heart.
Give you my heart. Give you my soul.
Oh, I give you my heart.
Give you my heart. Give you my soul.
Oh, yes, I do, Lord. I give you my heart. Lift your voice to Jesus and sing it. Lord, I give you my heart.
Give you my heart. Give you my soul.
One more time. You just, you do it. Come on. I give you my heart, Jesus.
I give you my heart.
I give you
my soul.
One more time. Do it again. I give you my heart.
I give you my heart.
I'm yours. All I want is you, Jesus. All I want is you, Jesus. Jesus, all I want is you.
I love you all.
In the morning when I rise, Expectantly I lift my eyes and I see you. Gazing on your heavenly throne, in your presence I'm at home, here with you. Like the Holy Spirit is here. This is different. We usually are more upbeat than this, but you know what? God's probing hearts tonight. He's searching motives. We just lay them open to you, Jesus. Search our motives, God. Anything in us that's not pure, Lord, we just want to worship you. All we want is more of you, Jesus. Nothing in this world compares to the love that I can share alone with you. Jesus. And there is nothing that is so real as the things that you reveal when I'm with you. Sing it to him now. And all I want. And all.
I
Yesterday.
More than yesterday, I need you.
I need you more, Jesus. I need you more than words can say.
More than words can say, I need you more. I need you more than ever before. I need you more. I need you more.
More than the air, sing it.
More than the air I breathe, more than the song I sing, more than the next heartbeat, more than anything, and Lord, as time goes by, I'll be by your side, 'cause I never. I never want to go back to my old life. I need you more.
Jesus. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. Oh, I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. I praise you, Jesus. 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 Good. The Lord is good. Magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. And as we enter into the house of the Lord, we sing praises. Praises to our God. Magnify, oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. And as we enter into the house of the Lord, we sing praises.
Praises to our God.
Sing with me, church. Let's do it again. Oh, magnify the Lord. Everybody sing.
Oh, magnify the Lord with me.
Let us exalt his name.
Let us exalt his name together.
As we enter.
As we enter into the house of the Lord. We sing praises
to our God.
For the Lord is great.
Yeah.
great is he who's the King of kings and the Lord of lords. He is wonderful. Come on, girls, sing.
Great is he who's the King of kings and the Lord of lords. He is wonderful.
Do it again. Great is he. Join in together here. I want all the altos out there to sing this part with me. Great is he. Come on, ladies.
Who's the King of kings
and the Lord of lords?
And the Lord of lords.
He is wonderful.
He is wonderful.
Come on, do it again, alto. Sing out here.
Great is he.
Who's
the King of kings
and the Lord of lords?
Wonderful.
Now without y'all, just out here, alto, sing it. Great. Come on, ladies. Oh, think about what you're singing. That's good. And don't forget your part. Sopranos, I want you to sing this. Here we go. Sing.
Hallelujah.
Come on, ladies, open up your mouth. Just you, come on.
Hallelujah.
We're going to do this. And when we get to the part that goes, "He is wonderful," we're going to make the roof come off this little teepee. All right? Think about what you're singing. Now let me hear everybody go. All right, we're going to go through the parts one more time, and we're on with you. Here we go, altos. Hallelujah. Where are they at? Great is He. Come on, girls. Sing.
Some folks, you're looking around going, "My Lord and my God, what is this?" Let me tell you, let me just explain something to you. Let me explain something. You cannot put up a sign in front of a church that says revival and have 2.2, it's more than that now, but 2.2 million people come through because nothing's happening. You can't, it can't be done, friend. People are smarter than that. Okay? Now, if you're visiting for the first time, I want you to listen up. People are smarter than that. They're not going to come from Norway, Scotland, Japan, Iceland. They've come from all over the world, 110 nations, all over this nation. They've come. They're not going to spend thousands of dollars on tickets and then hundreds of dollars on hotels because nothing's going on. They're coming here, and this is, let me just show you something. This is why people are so excited here, because God is touching us. Okay? We're not talking. We're not talking about religion. We're talking about an intimate relationship with Jesus. How many? Let's just take this youth choir. Let's just take a sample up here. How many of you kids, you've either been saved or you were backslidden and got right with God? You're saved or backslidden in this revival? Lift up your hand. Almost every one of them. Now, that's why Now, I could point out, there's one young lady up there who was a witch. She was into Satanism when she came to the revival. She's up there singing her lungs out. You don't know the stories, friend. And I know some of you are looking up there going, you know, you're going, man, look at them get into this thing. Friend, they've gotten out of a lot. That's why they're getting into it. Jesus! Jesus! Now, how many in this congregation, including those on the platform, how many has God delivered you from, don't lift your hand yet, from drugs, alcohol, maybe suicidal thoughts, depression, maybe healed your marriage? God has done something powerful, delivered you from a vice, something that had a hold of you. How many would lift your hand and say, God set me free? Well, now let me tell you, you can put your hand down. There's reason to shout. There's reason to get excited. Come on, Benny. Folks, let loose. Let loose and let God have his way tonight in your life. Let the Lord have his way.
Do you have the harmonica on back there? Turn the harmonica. Come on, Chester.
Turn that
harp
on.
I'm
praise the Lord, would you? Give him a good clap of it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Let's see, I had a lady standing here. What's God done for you? All right, well, come on now. Come on. What about you? God done something for you? Is it good? Is it real good? All right, come on. I need a man. What about this guy up there in the balcony, the blue shirt on? Has God done something for you? All right, let's hear it. Come on. We're unbalanced tonight. Everybody's been from this side of the church. What about over here? You got a good testimony? What about y'all? Which one of you's got the best testimony? Wave your hand. You got the best one? All right, she's waving her hand. Come on. All right, let's see here. How many we got? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Let's make it a divine number. Number 7. Let's see. Is that 7? Okay. Well, we're going to start off with you first. You was the first one. Come on out. Y'all come on over this way. Hi, what's your name?
My name is Joy.
Joy? Mm-hmm. Do you have joy?
Amen.
Was your name right?
And praise God. He knew me before I was formed.
Okay. So you got the right name.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Okay. Well, what's God done for you? Where are you from?
I'm from Tupelo, Mississippi.
Tupelo, Mississippi.
Praise God. I came here a year ago, spring break. I teach high school English. Don't check my grammar. I'm on vacation.
You teach high school English?
Yes. I can't stand up. I came here a year ago, and our pastor was encouraging us to come, and I was just seeking God for a higher level. I just was tired of playing church. I've been a Christian all my life, but I was just tired of playing church. I wanted to get real with Jesus. And so I came searching for some answers, and I have to tell you, it was great, but it was like church at home. And I left, and I was really kind of mad because I was like, well, that was great. I enjoyed the singing. I enjoyed the service, but I didn't feel like I got anything. Well, the next morning I woke up, and my life has never been the same since.
How many people come here and they say that they didn't really get what they came for, and they wake up the next day or the day after that and their whole life changes? What do you think that is? It's not just something to do with English teachers, is it?
The power of God. Oh, it's just God.
What happened when you woke up?
Well, I had forever, since I've been through puberty, I've always had problems with my female problems, and it's just always been minor surgery after minor surgery, and so for 9 days, this is awful. I'm sorry, Mother. I know you'll watch this someday. For 9 days, God.
Tell me about it.
For 9 days, God just took things out of my body and healed me, and it went on for about 9 days. And then the next morning when I woke up, the lady that we stayed with, she fried sausage, and it smelled so horrible to me that I could not eat meat, and I hadn't eaten meat since then. And I've learned about fasting and intercession, and I've battled weight for 15 years and 18 years, I'm sorry, Lord. And I've lost 70 pounds in a year, and God has just changed my life.
70 pounds.
And I teach public school, and, you know, last year I had such a horrible year, and this year God has just made my enemies my footstool. And, you know, I went back to school, and I was like, Lord, I'm tired of playing teacher, too. And so everything that I teach, God gives me a way to show him. I don't care if it's Julius Caesar. I don't care if it's a verb. I preach and I teach. And we just had someone from FCA come to our school, RV Vine, anyway, he was from FCA, and we had over 500 kids change their hearts and their lives for Jesus. And, you know, the Lord gave me the opportunity to walk out on the the basketball court with him, and he showed me that those were my seeds that I'd planted, and that was his harvest through me, and I just give him the glory.
All right.
All right, y'all together?
Hi, what's your name?
My name's Danielle Morris.
Yeah, where are you from?
Well, I was here, and the Lord raised me up as a baby Christian from 88 to 91, then he took me out to California, and then my dad was a member here too, and he died twice in 94, and most of my brothers and sisters went out to California too, and then the Lord brought us back here, and it was during the time when God was, God had talked to Pastor and told him about prayer and praying, and they had all the banners out on the Sunday nights, and we were all praying, and they prayed for my dad, and then Pastor came to the hospital and prayed for my dad, and he woke up, and Pastor gave him a hug. It was awesome. Anyway, the Lord was calling me. It was my fiance at the time. We were getting married in October. That was August. And he called us back here. He said, I want you back here to help with the harvest. And we said, okay, Lord, you got to make a way. Well, my dad passed away a year ago this February. And so we came out, and the Lord brought us to the revival, too. And we really felt it in our spirits, Lord, you're bringing us back here, but you got to make a way. You got to do it. And we were in debt and other things going on and everything. And we had two children, you know, and then the Lord says, I want you back to help with the harvest. I have to use you. And I'm like, oh, okay, Lord, do it. And so, well, he did it. He made it so that we had no other choice. We would have been on the streets if we didn't come here. And he also got us out of a lot of debt before that. Then while we've been here, this is just since right before Thanksgiving last year, he's given us a 3-bedroom house. He's provided all that. We couldn't bring our furniture with us. We stuck it in storage in California. And he gave us most of all the furniture we need. He's provided money. He's just provided everything that we've needed. Both of us don't have jobs right now, but the Lord is really taking care of us. It blows me away. With our tax return money, my husband's going back to California next week to go get our stuff. And he's just blessing us. We're in the cleansing stream program right now, and God made a way for that. We didn't have the money for that, and a lady from Michigan paid for it. And it's just...
That's important. God bless you, sweetheart. Yeah. Hi. Hello, brother. How you doing?
Doing good.
What's your name?
Dennis.
Dennis, yeah. Where are you from?
Plumpton, Alabama.
Plumpton, Alabama.
Well, what's God done for you?
Man, he delivered me from drugs.
Drugs?
Yeah. So hey.
What happened?
Spirit of the Lord on
you. Spirit of the Lord on you? No, I mean, what happened?
I've been on drugs about 20 years.
20 years? Wow. What kind of drugs was you on?
Morphine, methadone, and dilatos. I was pretty bad on running dope. You know, pretty bad on taking pills too, you know. But I can't.
So what happened? 20 years worth after being on drugs for 20 years. How'd you wind up here?
Well, my people's been praying for me. Yeah, yeah. So I came here January 31st.
Of this year?
This year, yeah. And I heard Lyndell talk about deliverance of drugs and stuff. And I heard Steve preaching on about his coming. But I couldn't come to the altar. I just couldn't do it.
How come you couldn't come?
Something had me.
Something had you?
Yeah.
Reckon what had you?
The devil. That's right. And so I went back.
How did it feel when the devil had you?
I just couldn't get out of my seat.
How did it feel? Like you just bound?
That's right. I was bound. I was unhappy.
Well, talk to somebody out there tonight that may be like that. They may have been here the whole week and haven't been able to come. What would you say to them?
Oh, man, I tell you, just cry, man, to the Lord, I'm telling you, because I tell you, he changed my heart, and he gave me a new mind, you know, and I'm free, man. I'm free. And I just love the Lord for that.
So you came here January the 31st from Flemington. And you finally kicked the devil.
Yes, I kicked him.
Did you have them boots on when you kicked him?
Oh, yes. And I stomped him, too.
I'll tell you what, y'all not up here on the platform, but I saw that coming. Man, he had the power of God all over him. Pull him back up. He can talk some more. Get on up here, brother. Come on back up here. So you got here on January the 31st.
Yeah.
And you pinned in your seat. Well, when did you finally, what finally got you up here?
The Lord.
The Lord.
Yeah.
When you came, it was hard to believe you was actually up here, wasn't it?
That's right. Well, that's how much he loves me, you know.
Did you feel like God loved you?
Oh, yes.
All those years you was on drugs, did you feel like he was against you?
No, I knew he loved me. That's what I just was in my own little corner, you know.
Yeah. You felt like you'd failed God?
Yeah.
You felt like a bad person?
That's right.
But God loved you?
Yes, he did.
Well, was you used to going to church?
No.
You weren't used to going to church. So when you came in here, what was your first impression when you came in here? What did you feel? What did you think about all this stuff?
Well, I knew it was real. I felt the presence of the Lord and I walked in the door.
So not being churched and not really serving God, but you knew when you walked in here that was God?
Oh, yes. Yes.
You think other people that don't live for God, do you think they can tell too?
Yes. Yes.
Well, I guarantee you, you're going to make it. I can see it in your eyes. You're going to make it. God's with you. Your name is Dennis. So, is there anything else?
I just want to praise the Lord.
You got the power of God all over you, hadn't you?
Yeah, man.
Has it been like this?
No.
Has it been like this? You reckon there's something on this platform?
Oh, yes. Yes.
You reckon it is? Yeah. I know there is.
Yeah. There ain't no doubt about it.
God bless you, man.
God bless y'all.
God bless you, buddy.
Bless you, bro.
Give Dennis a good hand, folks. We love you, man. Help him down. Help him down. Hey, how's it going? What's your name?
Daniel.
Huh?
Daniel.
Bo. Dennis and Daniel. You got old Daniel here. Was you the one thrown in the lion's den?
I don't think so.
You won?
No.
Where are you from?
Tallahassee.
Tallahassee?
Yeah.
What's going on?
Well, I came here like 2 weeks ago, and I hated God. I hated everything to do with him. Didn't care.
Why'd you hate God?
Just, I had the devil all over me, you know, and hooked on all kinds of things, drugs, sex, violence, and it was...
How old are you?
15.
15?
Yes.
So, man, 15 years the devil did a job on you, didn't he?
Yeah.
I mean, how'd you wind up here at Brownsville?
I brought a switchblade to school, and I got caught with it somehow. And the principal there had dared me, actually, to come over here.
The principal? So let me get this straight. Let me get this straight. You live in Tallahassee, right below Tallahassee.
Yeah.
go to high school there, got caught with a switchblade, and the principal dared you to come to Brownsville.
Yep.
You mean to tell me they heard about this revival all the way down in Tallahassee?
That's right.
So what did you tell the principal?
I thought about it, you know, and I called him up. I was like, yeah, I'll go, you know, whatever.
So you said, let's make a deal.
Yeah, and I was like, I'll go, you know.
I'll go to Brownsville.
Yeah.
What did you think when you came here?
When I first got here, you know, I just wanted to go smoke a cigarette. I was going crazy.
Did you come with somebody?
I came with, like, the school, you know. They had a little thing going there, and they brought a bunch of people from the school up here. And I rode up here with them, and I had, God had people watching out for me.
Yeah. And so they kind of brought you here.
Yeah.
So when you came in, what time did you get here?
I don't know.
You don't know?
Around dark.
What day was it?
Friday.
Friday?
Yeah.
And so you got here, of course, before church started.
Yeah.
And when you got here, did you feel anything?
No, I was like walking around outside, smoking a cigarette.
Smoking a cigarette?
Walking around, so.
So what happened when you got in here?
I walked in here and they had like people actually given up their seat and sat me down like right over here.
Somebody gave a seat up for you?
Yeah.
What did you think about that?
I didn't really care. I just sat down.
We want you to be honest, son, at all costs, okay? So they gave up their seat, and you took their seat, and you didn't really give a flip.
Nah, but after that, you know, and she was, like, just talking to me and stuff, you know, about God and everything. And
the woman that gave her seat up for you?
Yes.
Really?
Yeah, and after a while, you know, just talking to me and stuff, y'all was, like, singing and stuff, and y'all weren't even through preaching up here, and then God just grabbed me, yanked me up out of my seat, and I just ran up there and threw my face down on the altar and just started crying out to God.
What did it feel like? After 15 years of living your own life, what did it feel like when you came up here and fell on your face?
It was just, God filled me with so much love and so much joy that it just overwhelmed me.
It happened just like that, didn't it?
Just like that.
Just like that.
Everything just...
Can it happen to other people just like that?
It can happen to anyone on this earth, no matter who.
Well, since God touched you that night, how's things been?
It's been great. You know, He led me to burn like $1,000 worth of posters and stuff that I had stole, and just all kinds of things that were in the between me and him. And he's just been...
How'd you know that we're in between you and God?
Because he told me, you know.
The Lord told you.
I could feel it.
You could feel it?
I could feel it.
Yeah. What kind of posters were they?
Just had a crow poster, just mainly.
But before you came here and God touched your life, it really didn't matter to you, did it?
Nah.
Whatever happened to Switchblade?
The principal kept it. Never did get that back.
So you went by, you went from the Switchblade to the cross, didn't you?
Sure did.
Give Daniel a good hand. You never know. He could be the next Billy Graham. You never know. Friend, listen, you don't know what God's doing in people's lives. Eye has not seen nor ear heard. What's your name?
Angel.
Angel. Are you an angel?
I try to be.
You try to be? Well, where are you from?
Salisbury, Maryland.
You're from Maryland?
Mm-hmm.
Well, what in the world has God been doing for you?
My pastor came here and
my pastor came here in October, and she came back on a Wednesday night that we had prayer, and she said that the Lord led her here to let her know that she was religious, and that she had to come back, and we all had to clean out our houses, and the whole church just went under a spirit of repentance. And I had been away from God for 4 years, and
still in the church.
Still in the church.
Been away from God 4 years.
Been in church since I was 2. Yeah, from 4.
How old are you?
20.
20. So, you were still in church, but you've been away from God for 4 years. Mm-hmm. That's misery, isn't it?
Yeah, I was thinking I was living it up, but I wasn't. Yeah.
So she came back on Wednesday night and told y'all she'd been under spell of religion.
Yeah, and she was so broken, and she talked about Steve, how he talked that that the church was religious and we need to get out of it. And I was just sitting there just thinking it was going to be another service like all the rest. So I just been coming and sitting and doing whatever, but I just, God really convicted me, and I started crying, and I knew that when I repented to God, I had to follow through with everything, because I was going with a God for 3 years, and I've been unhappy the last year, and I didn't know how to get out of it. But the Lord had kept leading him to break up with me, but I would always go back to him, just keep breaking up with me. And my mom said, Angel, you need to listen. God is trying to get a hold of you by using him. But I would just go back to him and break up with him and everything. But this night, he touched me. He touched the whole church. I said, I got up, I yelled and I screamed. I said, God, I am so sorry. He touched all of us. The whole church just went out. We got up. We fell down. We got up. We fell down. And that's my family right over there.
That's your family?
Yeah, my mom and my dad.
What about him, Mama? Come up here a minute. Come on up here. Bring the other one up here, too. Bring the daddy up here, too. Come on up here, brother. Come on up here, daddy. Shoo. So what happened?
So I got up and repented, and I told my pastor before the service was over. I said, Pastor, I said, I'm going to go home and throw in my birth control pills. And I went home. I threw away my birth control pills. I threw away all my tapes.
Who told you to do that?
God.
What's your name?
Willa Mae.
Willa Mae?
Yes.
What you think about your daughter, Angel?
She's all over. Oh, God.
What you think about it?
It is just awesome. Oh, God, I live with a brand new woman. Oh, she's real. It's real, Pastor. It's real.
Say it one more time.
Oh, he's real! He's real.
How do you know? It is real. Are you sure? Are you positive? Well, I take it that you had a fallen angel. I'm thinking that you had a fallen angel for a daughter.
Yes, I did. I tell you the truth. Oh, God. Oh, Chakarama. See your shade. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, God.
Has she hurt your heart?
Yes, yes.
She disappointed
yes.
you?
A lot.
When you named her angel, what was your expectations for naming her?
Amen.
You wanted an angel, didn't you?
Yes, I did. I tell you, when I had her in my first year of college, and I was going through so much depression at the time because my family life was, you know, in an uproar. And she was my reason for maintaining my sanity. It came to a point that I felt like one day I got up one morning and I was just so tired of the stress and feeling like I was by myself. And that I said, Lord, it might just be as easy to walk out in the street. It was about that time that I felt her moving on the inside of me. And all I could do was just rub my stomach and say, Lord, you have sent me an angel to save my soul. Oh, God, and I just named her angel while she was in my stomach because I just felt like I had to go on for her. You know, I didn't know whether he or she, but when she came, it came out a girl, I said, that's your name. That is your name.
I'm glad it wasn't a boy and call him angel.
I'm glad it wasn't either. Amen.
What's God done? I mean, your pastor come back up there and got y'all all stirred up.
Yes, Lord God. This is our pastor. Ah!
She ain't through talking yet. Get her up. Get that pastor up over there. Can't be laying down on the job. Time to testify. Turn around here. Shoo! So this is your pastor. Well, what in the world got a hold of y'all?
Jesus. Oh, the power of God. Oh, I tell you, she came back. Oh, my God, we had never seen her so broken. So broken. Oh, she was just broken. If I've ever seen broken, she was it.
Let me get this straight now. She was broken.
Just broken. I mean, she was just going through the church, and I mean, she was crying, she was stomping, she was rolling, and she was just pleading with us, saying, saints, we gotta get right with God. We just gotta get right with God. Hallelujah. Just had to get right with God.
Well, did you do it?
Yes.
Did you do it?
Yes, we did.
Hello, got right.
Yes, we did. We got right with God that night. We just began to repent. As my daughter say, the spirit of repentance just went through the church, and we begin to go to each other and just go to her and tell God how sorry we were. Amen. And just move.
What was y'all doing? Just having church?
We were showing up just occupying.
Just occupying.
Just occupying. That's it. Just occupying.
So. Just occupying. What that means is you weren't doing nothing.
Not a whole bunch of nothing. No, we were getting tired of that.
Tired of it.
Tired of that.
So now you're having church.
Yes. Yes. Oh, yes. Yes.
So what's church like now?
Oh, my God. We're having a good time, Sam.
Well, I'm going to be praying for y'all that y'all get free.
Yeah. Good God, we'll fly away for sure.
What?
Just a wonderful.
This is your pastor. Well, Pastor, what's your name?
Gloria Ortiz.
Gloria. That's a good name.
Praise God.
So, God touched you while you
was. Oh, yes. Hallelujah. Yes.
I see the tears on your face. What's that all about?
God delivered me from a spirit of religion.
Well, come up here now. Come out here. Look at that camera up yonder and tell people what religion is.
Religion is just hanging around the cross without being on the cross.
So you're just hanging around the cross.
You know, I lived a committed life, but as a pastor, at times you just, it comes a time the struggle gets so hard. You know, it just gets so hard and you want to bring the people to a commitment. And it gets so hard, and after a while you just say, well, you know, when I was first called to pastor it, you know, everybody said I was a hellfire and brimstone preacher, which, you know, everybody says it's not popular. Yeah. I found out since Brother Steve it is. And, you know, I said, well, you know, maybe I'll just try something else. Maybe I won't, you know, just, you know, be on the people so much. Maybe they'll just come around their own self. And you just get to the places, one of my members said, you just go through the motions. Yeah. You go through the motions and just pray one day, you know, God, you know, they'll just wake them up. And when I came here, and...
When did you come here?
I came here, this is my third time. I came here the early part of November.
Last year?
Last year. And I came with another lady pastor. And...
Did God touch her?
Yes, my God, yes, yes. And when Brother Steve began to preach and began to talk about religion and began to tell you why you were religious and... talked about the, I tell you, Steve, you fixed me up. You know, I was the first one at the altar when I found out that I was religious, a pastor, and I was religious. And when I got to the altar, well, before I got to the altar, this other pastor was standing with me, and I was convicted. I was convicted of a religious spirit. And I want you to know, saints of God, that as God begins to speak to your heart, I want you to know that the devil also starts to whisper in your ear.
What does he say?
He began to say to me, what is your friend, pastor, going to say about you going to the altar?
What will your friend say?
Then what will your friend say?
There's another pastor there with you.
Yes, and so I just left and came to the altar. When I got here, I knew I was convicted. But I said, my God, I better cover up this badge here because they're going to want to know what is a pastor doing at the altar, religious. But you know, the conviction of God was on my life so strong. And I love God. I love the Lord. And I love the work of God. And you know, and I didn't mind, you know, being seen. And when I did open up my eyes, I looked around and I saw there were many more pastors at the altar with badges on. But I want you to know that God set me free that night. And I went back to our church, as they said, and our next service was that Wednesday night. And I told the church, we have been in the spirit of religion. I said, and from now on, I'm not preaching but two messages, three messages. Repentance, I'm preaching against religion, and I'm preaching on holiness. Because holiness is the way. That's why I came into the church.
Well, how's it going?
Pastor, it is going fine. I was so, you know, when I came, the Lord just...
How'd the people take to your messages, your new messages?
Oh, just wonderful. I have a great congregation.
Didn't rattle no feathers?
No, they really had a spirit of repentance. As one of my angels...
What's going to happen if you do rattle some feathers?
I've already told them, Pastor. They know me. If I rattle feathers, I tell you, there's the door. Amen. We got to walk with God. Born with God.
So you ready?
I'm ready. Hallelujah. Am I ready? I'm ready. Yes, I'm ready.
I believe you are?
I'm ready. I'm ready.
If you're not, you're close to it.
I'm ready, Pastor. I'm ready. I'm ready.
So what about this guy here?
This is the chairman of my deacon board.
Chairman of your deacon board.
An angel's father.
Well, brother, if the deacons has got it, it's real.
Oh.
It's real.
Yes, it is.
What about it?
You know, I'm just excited just to be here. You know, just before when our pastor had went to Brownsville, she had made a phone call back to my wife. And she called everybody. I mean, and then it was an uproar. She called all the saints of God, and it was an uproar. It looked like, you know, the Spirit of God through the phone. Yeah. you know, from Brownsville, from our pastor to her. And when she got the message over, I mean, it was just like going through the whole city, you know, and she was calling everybody, even people that she didn't even know she called about the revival.
Who's that, your wife?
That's my wife there.
She called everybody?
Called everybody, the whole church and everybody. And we just went up, you know, in an uproar. You know, while she was on the phone, I was just praising God.
And the preacher was still down here?
The preacher was down here. She just made a phone call.
What y'all think about it?
You know, the whole church has changed. You know, in our, you know, we having revival right in our heart. You know, and you know, it's a burning and a consuming fire, you know, and I'm just excited.
It's different than church as usual, isn't it?
Like you said the other night, you know, you were saying about a pastor before all this had, you know, happened, you know, it was just a regular, you know, you're a pastor and regular. But now, it's just, you just can't explain it. It's just, you know, what y'all have here is so beautiful. You know, and we was here, we've been here all week since Tuesday, and, you know, and when I seen all of y'all come out, I said, my God, I can't believe that I'm here, you know. And we had the videos, and it seemed like, you know, we was right here with y'all, you know, looking at those videos, and we just praising God and everything right then.
Did you feel the power of God through the videos?
Feel the power of God through the videos. You know, I mean, our church just was lit up. We was on fire. You know, and I just thank God. I've been saved a good while, but, you know, it's always more and more of the Lord. You know, and I just want more and more, you know. And my God, when I get back, my God, I don't know what's going to happen when I get back. You know, she bought the whole staff. She bought the whole staff, and we got a lot more. She bought the
Y'all
whole
got some more?
The Lord told me to bring my staff. You want to do a work.
Y'all just stand up out there. Hey. All right. Great. So you think you're going to stay with Revival for a while?
Oh, yes, certainly. Certainly. Definitely.
Now, who is this?
Yeah.
It's your friend?
Yeah, we're kind of like best friends.
Well, I saw you crying a while ago. What's that all about?
He's delivered me from so many things.
Did God touch you when your pastor got back?
When she got back that Wednesday night, I chose not to go.
Well, you wasn't there.
Ain't no, but it carried right over to the next service, and she got me.
Well, how's your life changed since God got a hold of
you? I'm no longer in a state of depression. I know that I'm not alone.
How old are you?
I'm 22.
22. So you don't feel alone anymore?
No.
How do you feel now?
Oh, I have my band of angels. I have my church family. I feel like I have more now than I ever had before. Yes.
How's your life changed?
Well, even I was involved with God. I mean, and me and him have a child together. And sometimes, at times, he seemed kind of controlling. But I thank God through the tapes, and I got right with God. And then he came to church with me, and to this day, he saved himself.
He's what? He's saved.
He got saved and joined our church. Through these tapes that we've been getting from pastor from bringing from here.
So praise God. So it started with you, and then it went to you by long distance, and I guarantee when it hit you, it hit the whole city, didn't it? So God's touched your husband and your daughter and all kind of people.
Everybody.
Reckon what's gonna happen?
Oh, Jesus, I don't know. We're just going to run for Jesus. We're just going to run. We are just going to run, Pastor. We're just going to run. We're going to do what God said do. I'm telling you, the Lord gave our pastor prophecy just before we came down, and we've been reading it and rereading it. He was letting us know that this time was ordained for us to be here. Amen. That he had made a way. And not only that, I want to say we thank God for a loving leader.
Yeah.
I mean, one that God has given after his own heart. I mean, the church took it upon itself to pay for this trip for us. Yeah, yeah. The only thing we have to pay for was our food.
Now listen.
I mean, we didn't have to pay for anything.
Now listen.
Yeah.
She's going to have a tough time eventually. Mm-hmm. Hell's going to come after her.
Yeah.
When it does,
oh, yeah.
You be just as excited when hell comes after
yeah.
her. Now, wait a minute. You be just as excited and just as enthused when hell comes after her and stand with her and be committed to her because she's going to need you.
Yeah.
And deacon, you stand with her.
Yeah.
Hell ain't going to let you go along without coming after you. But greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. I
bless you.
Look what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done. He healed my body. He touched my mind. He saved me just in time. Oh, I call to praise his name. He says just the same.
There's some folks here, they don't know. You don't know what this sister's talking about. Religion,
yes.
Freedom. Just getting in the presence of God, letting him have his way. Everyone stand. I've got in my... need help on this. I've got in my library a lot of old books. One of the reasons I love the old ones is a lot of them, they were published once and they're never published again. And journals and diaries of great men and women of God. This one's from the turn of the 1800s. It's a Methodist preacher. And throughout his writings, he talks about the power coming down. Now, I'm not going to ask how many Methodists are here tonight, but I know they're here. But I read this. I was reading through his journal. Well-esteemed pastor, evangelist, a man who was used mightily of God. And he talks about people being stricken by the power of God right in the middle of his message. Wham! Hit the ground. And in here he says, others think this is quite unusual. Others say that that can't be God because God's not the author of confusion. And he says in his journal, he said, listen. He said, what we see in this is as we back off and let God have his way, there ain't nothing confusing about it. Nothing confusing at all. Because the people get up in love with Jesus. And friend, look at me, everybody. God can do in a couple seconds, Pastor, what you can't do in years. He can touch a heart in a couple seconds. You can beat away at that brick wall for decades. But God can hit somebody, get a hold of them, and change them in a heartbeat. That's one of the reasons I love the old copies of the old books, even the ones that have been reprinted. A lot of times they leave out the power. The reprints. They leave out the strange incidences. I'm telling you the truth. Our heritage, what this sister's talking about, what they're experiencing in the church, if you went back 200 years, it was way of life. It was a way of life, the power to come down. People screaming out, people falling to the ground. It was just all part of a church service. God's working on some people. He's working on you. He's going to get that religion out of you one way or the other, Mom. He's going to get it out of you. Well, I'm going to give an altar call in just a minute. But before we do that, we're going to pray and ask the Lord to speak to our hearts. And I'm going to revisit something. How many here were not here on Wednesday night? Lift your hand up. That's what I thought. I'm just going to revisit something tonight. The Lord spoke to me just a minute ago when I went back in the back room. Spoke to me. Just going to touch on something just for a minute. And then many of you in this room that are away from God, you're going to get right with God. You're going to get so right with God, friend. Did you hear this testimony of this lady that was in church, been in church ever since she was, what, two? Living in sin for the last 4 years, living away from God, but in church. Taking birth control pills, just whatever, que sera, sera. But come Sunday, probably come prayer meeting, right there. Our churches are full of people like that. I'm telling you, I'm going to say that again. Our churches are full of people like that. And you might be able to fool a few people. But you've never fooled the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Ever. You've never fooled the Trinity. And those of you that were not here last night, how many were not here last night? Slipped your hand up. Wow. Sometimes I wonder why I change sermons night after night. Just like, this week's message will be, and just preach the same thing night after night. But last night we had a Lutheran lady stood up and was baptized, and she was baptized as an infant in Germany. Came to the States. Didn't get involved in religion or anything, just came here and lived a good moral life. Felt that that was good enough. Boy, you're talking about an arrow in the heart of America right there. Thought I was just fine until somebody invited her and her husband to the Brownsville Revival. And she realized infant baptism wasn't going to save her. Saying that she was a Lutheran was not going to save her. Saying you're a Pentecostal ain't going to save you. Speaking in tongues ain't going to save you, friend. Only the blood of Jesus applied in your life, living a holy life, getting the sin out, is going to save you. Oh, listen. Turn that camera over here right now. Turn that camera. Y'all just be patient. Friend, let me tell you something.
You've tuned in at the right time. First of all, let me say, I never speak to the television audience at the beginning of my message. I never do. But tonight I'm going to do this, and I'm not preaching a long message, but I'm going to tell you, sir, don't budge. Sister, don't budge, because God's going to get a hold of you. He knows where you're at, and you're guilty of substitution. You have substituted little works and a few things here and a few things there for the power of Christ. You settle for a program. You'll settle for being involved in a church and maybe even teaching the young girls in the church and maybe teaching Sunday school. You substituted that for a relationship with Jesus. You don't have a relationship with Jesus. And I'm speaking to one of you right now. I know who you are. I can feel it in my spirit. You're so far from God. You're watching this by mistake. You're flipping through the channels. You're watching this by mistake, but you can't turn it off, can you? Go ahead and try it. Go ahead and try it. Change the channel. Let me tell you, you can go watch a soap opera, you can go watch Friend, this is prime time, you can watch a movie, and you'll be watching that thing for a few seconds, your heart's going to be doing this. You're going to be going, what's he saying, what's he saying, what's he saying back on that other channel? What's he talking about on that other channel? So don't change it, friend, stay right where you're at, because God's going to speak to you. He's going to speak to you. Stay tuned. Everyone here, I want you to pray with me. We're going to ask the Lord to speak to our hearts and to change our lives. I want everyone to pray, everyone that's a God hater. You don't love God, you don't believe in God. Just like, what was this, Daniel, what was it? Was that Daniel with a name like that, buddy? Just get in, all right? Somebody marked you 15 years ago. But you can come here like that, you know, on a dare. And somebody can give you your seat, and you can go, and you sit down in their seat, and you can. People get drug in here all the time. Matter of fact, I've had people drag people up to me, and they'll drag this snot up to me, you know, and they'll be standing there like this. And I had a father right here and a mother look up to me and say, save our daughter, right in front of the daughter, just like that. You know, just anything. You know, they're desperate. They've drug her in this place, told her they're going to take her to Pensacola Beach and brought her to church instead. And I turned to the parents, I said, I can't save your daughter. But I turned to the daughter, I said, let me tell you something right now. God brought you here. And you can act like a snot, you can act rebellious, you can act any way you want to, but God brought you here. Don't you ever forget that. And your mom and your dad love you enough to bring you here. Some kids think love is when you just let your kid go free. Let them have some freedom. No, teenager, love was when mom and dad says, I'm sorry, you can't go. I'm not going to let you go out tonight. You're staying home tonight. But mama, no, you're staying home tonight. You're staying home. Love is when you come home at 12 and you're supposed to be home at 11 and your dad says for the next 2 weeks, you're restricted. That's love. That's love. That's love. Well, all my other friends get to stay out later. Friend, I've got friends. Matter of fact, I've got a friend that's coming to this revival. His parents let him. This is one of my old drug buddies. Matter of fact, he was in my rock and roll band. And this guy, his parents used to let him smoke dope in the house. Smoke pot. Now, 30 years later, he's an alcoholic. His whole life has been wasted. So don't go comparing yourself by what your other friends' parents let you do. You thank God if your parents say, listen, you're staying home tonight, somebody loves you. And somebody brought you here tonight, friend. If you're here under divine appointment. And how many are here tonight? Lift your hand up. That's good. You got to see what I see from here, man. People are going. Or they'll go. How many are here tonight? There you go. Everyone pray with me right now. Dear Jesus, speak to my heart. Change my life. In your precious name. Amen. You may be seated. Don't get too comfortable. Wasn't going to do this, but turn with me to Matthew. What I had planned tonight, I was going to review some stuff. Matter of fact, the message tonight was entitled, Tell Him What You Told Him. But I'm going to just stay on a few pages right here, friend, and then we're going to pray. God's already spoken. Some of y'all have been hit by from all sides. You don't even realize it yet. You're mortally wounded. You know what those are? Those are the arrows of the Lord. Look this way, everybody. Those are the arrows of the Lord. You'll be sitting out there and you'll be religious. And this lady says something about religion. And he'll go, phew, you've been hit. Then somebody else will talk about holiness. She'll talk about some young boy just been saved 2 weeks will say something like posters on the wall. You know, is anybody listening? Another girl will talk about birth control pills. And you're sitting there going, oh. The Bible says his arrows are sharp. Talk about the Lord's got a quiver, friend. He's got a quiver full of arrows. His arrows are sharp. They strike like lightning, and they stick fast. Pastors, that's a message, by the way. You look up the arrows of God. They stick fast. That means once you're under conviction, nobody can get that arrow out of you. You can slip out of this sanctuary, friend, like one lady did. She fought. I don't know how you get away from these altar calls, but somehow one or two do. They'll get away from the altar call and slip out. One lady did. She left the revival. She went home and stayed up all night long with arrows sticking out of her. The next morning, as soon as it was time, she called the church. Church offices had just opened, and she said, is it too late? They said, for what? To get saved. I've been up all night long. I missed the altar call last night. I've been up all night long tossing and turning. You can't sleep with arrows sticking out of you, friend. The only one that can take that arrow out is the Holy Ghost. And he can do it down here at this altar. Conviction is a marvelous thing. Thank God for it. If you feel the presence of God, you need to thank him for it. Verse 13 of Matthew 16. This is just going to take a couple minutes, I can tell. Pastor, I've been beating this pulpit with my ring so hard. I took my ring to the jeweler the other day, and he said, my God, what are you doing to your ring? He said, it's flat. And so he said, quit doing that. So I cut my hand like this and go, Matthew 16, we just get excited up here, friend. And you got to do something, you know. And I don't want to throw anything at you. So Matthew 16, 13. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he began asking his disciples, saying, who do people say that the Son of Man is? And they said, some say John the Baptist, and others Elijah, but still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. Sister, they're going to be talking about your church like that. What's going on over at that church? Well, some say it's the power of God. Others say it's a mockery. Some say they're flip-flopping around like a bunch of fish out of water. It's always, friend, thank God somebody's talking. Thank God they're talking. At least they're talking about your church and not some football game. Verse 15, and he said to them, but who do you say that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said to him, blessed are you, Simon Barjona, because flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not overpower it, or gates of hell. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. I love that. I love it, friend. Let me just talk to you for a few minutes. I preached Wednesday night on what on earth do you believe? What on earth do you believe? Now, if you're in this place, and how many are in this place? We've done some research. We've just taken about 8 or 10 of your major denominations because people are so quick to say, I'm Methodist. I'm Episcopalian. I'm Presbyterian. I mean, they're quick to say that. How many have heard that kind of stuff? I don't need to go to your church, sis. I'm Episcopalian. Well, we've done some research on the foundation of all these denominations. Don't you ever come to me with sin in your life and tell me you're Episcopalian. Don't you ever come to me and with sin in your life and say you're Presbyterian. Don't you dare come to me with a beer in your hand and tell me you're a Methodist. Don't you dare come to me and if you're hateful and mean to your wife and say you're a Pentecostal. Because as I look at the foundation of all these denominations, the reasons they split apart were little minor differences. The foundation of every one of our denominations are just all parallel. They all talk about Jesus being the Son of God, the only God. And the sacrifice offered for the forgiveness of sins. Lutherans, listen up. What do Lutherans believe about heaven? They believe heaven is a reward for the saint. But I can take you to Lutherans right now that don't believe in hell. But if you look at the foundation of your denomination, friend, yes, you do. Luther believed in hell. The Lutherans believe that hell is the eternal punishment for the sinner. Are you telling me, Steve, that in that sanctimonious building, those stained glass windows with the chimes and the pipe organ and the chandeliers and the religious emblems and the crosses, and you're telling me in there that they believe that people are going to burn for eternity in hell if they don't ask Jesus Christ into their life? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So you better be careful when you say, I'm a Lutheran. I'm a Methodist. You'll have Luther going, Watch your tongue. And every one of them, from the Presbyterians to the Episcopalians, and I'm not going to go through them all, but I got them all in front of me. Methodist, Baptist, Assemblies of God, Church of God, the Brethren. It goes on and on. Every one of them, it's all the same. The Bible. Every one of the denominations say it is the final authority, the final authority of all things. It is the clear, perfect, inspired, and authoritative Word of God. That's what the Bible is. And they all say you got to believe it and you got to live by it. Whoa! That takes care of adultery in an Episcopalian church. That takes care of fornication in a Methodist church. That takes care of backbiting in an Assembly of God church. What do you believe? It's pop quiz time, friend. The other day, I read to you some sermons, and I threw them all away, and I had to reprint them today because I didn't think I'd ever use them again. And so I reprinted them this morning. These sermons, how many are with me for a few minutes? These are sermons from our nation. Those of you from other nations, bear with me for a few minutes. I'm sort of ticked at this one. But here, in our nation, in our country, the U.S. of A., these are all messages preached at Congress, to the Senate, and to governors. These are not church messages. These were all preached in political arenas. I've got a huge book of these. This one. How many remember Jonathan Edwards? He said, we must all restrain from all vices those practiced in private and from vices, drinking, smoking in general. Nothing is so useful as a full belief of final judgment. Think about this. You're sitting in Congress. And a subsequent state of rewards and punishments in which all sin not renounced by sincere repentance shall be punished, and every man shall receive according to that which he has done in his body, whether it be good or evil. How'd you like to be in Congress, Senator? That was, you know, message for the day. Here's one for those of you from New Hampshire. Preached at the state elections The fear of God is the best guard against temptation. The fear of God. I'm telling you, Pastor, we've lost the fear of God in this nation. By the fear of God, human passions are regulated. That means you control yourself because you fear God Almighty. And men are influenced to run the way of God's commandments. The fear of God. I love these, man. But I'm going to keep moving tonight. Listen to this one. This is to the governor and the General Assembly in Connecticut. These are sermons, friends, preached in places like your capital. The chief glory of the gospel is that it opens the way of salvation to a fallen world and contains the words of eternal life. And were not this its great and distinguishing excellence, it would be of so much less importance to mankind, as the concerns of eternity are greater than those of time. It does everything for our happiness in this world, which can be affected by the most excellent precepts of morality, don't lose me here, friend, and by instructing us in all the duties we owe to God. Listen. And our neighbors and ourselves. At the same time, it binds us to the most unremitting diligence and perseverance in all good works by the solemn account we must give to our righteous judge for all the deeds that have been done in our body. He goes on to say, the only reason we have assembled here in this Congress, in this Capitol building, is to further the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Powerful stuff. Now, this would be acceptable if this was in a church. Listen to this one, preached in Hartford. He said, we are ambassadors for God to a revolted world. In the guilt and wretchedness of this revolt, we ourselves are personally involved. Jesus, in extremest agonies, both of body and soul, has died for our salvation. Those of you that think back in those days they just talked about God, no, sir. It was all Jesus. To stand up in front of the governor and say, Governor, I'd like to offer a prayer in Jesus' name. Everyone went, Amen. Is anybody listening tonight? Something's gone on in our nation, friend. I love this one right here. This was preached. The House of Representatives. The governor. Massachusetts was there. This was to a bunch of legal professionals. Those of you that are in the political arena, those of you at home that are listening, congressmen, I encourage you to go back and revisit the structure of this nation. Here's a man preaching to these senators and governors. Listen to what he says. Remember, sirs, that though now you sit upon the bench, you must one day stand at the bar. If you have been with God in the judgment and studied to do justice, to discountenance vice, and to encourage virtue, you will be acquitted in that great audit day. And Christ the judge, see that right there? Christ the judge. Is anybody listening? You know what that did? That annihilated every other God that people believe in. And Christ the judge will confer inexpressible honor upon you if you've obeyed him. Then he goes, but if you have forsaken God and you have been an unjust judge, woe unto you. Could you imagine, Governor, look into my eyes. Woe unto you. A more severe and tremendous sentence will be passed upon you than you ever passed upon the most horrendous criminal. Now, therefore, be instructed, ye judges of the earth, and serve the Lord with fear. What on earth do you believe, friend? Y'all with me just for a minute? I picked this up just the other day in an old bookstore. This is printed by the United States government. It's about 50 years old. Not old, it's not an old book. But this is back when Peter Marshall was a chaplain of the Senate. And I read through this thing, friend, and wept. This is one of his prayers. This is just 1948. What's that, 50 years ago? O Savior of the world, thou who hast a plan for peace and a program for all the nations, make it plain. I like that. Make it plain and make us see it clearly, that we may find that which will work and will have thy blessing. Listen to what he says. This is to the Senate. Save us from hotheads that would lead us to act foolishly, and from cold feet that would keep us from acting at all. May thy Holy Spirit work among us. Friend, this is just a few years ago. May I remind you, the government of the United States printed the book. This is printed in the front. It is printed on government printing presses. 1949, the United States Government Printing Office, Washington. Why? Because they wanted everyone to have one. Your tax dollars at work back then, friend. He says, may thy Holy Spirit work among us to lead us into all truth through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, I'm going to move on. Listen to this prayer. Forgive us, Lord Jesus. I wish I could read something different for you, friend, but I can't. You know, those of you that are so backslidden, it's scary. I wish I could say, forgive us, O God that dwelleth in the heavenlies. Little g. But no, I'm sorry, friend. It's just here in black and white. This is our heritage. Forgive us, the Congress, the Senate, the President. Forgive us, Lord Jesus, for doing the things that make us uncomfortable and guilty when we pray. Y'all didn't hear that. Forgive us, Jesus, for doing the things that make us uncomfortable and guilty when we pray. He was saying, Jesus, forgive us. When we get right now to this point, Jesus, we feel like worms because we're in sin. We say that we believe in God, yet we doubt your promises. We say that in God we trust, yet we worry and try to manage our own affairs. We say that we love you, O Jesus, and yet we do not obey you. We believe that thou hast the answers to all our problems, and yet we do not consult you. Forgive us, Lord, for our lack of faith and the willful pride that ignores the way, the truth, and the life. Will you reach down and change the gears within us that we may go forward with you? In Jesus' name, amen. Well, it's too powerful. I'm telling you, friend, in these last days, I'm going for the gold. I'm going for the juggler. Ain't nothing gonna stop this old boy. You know what we got? We got presidents turning in their graves. They can feel it. I'm telling you, friend, I'm talking about spiritually speaking. Our heritage is pregnant with people that would stand on this platform and going, amen, 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 amen. Mark Twain used to say, it's not the scripture that I don't understand that bothers me. It's those that I do understand. Who do you say that he is, friend? Jesus is asking you a pointed question tonight. Who is he? Well, he's the God of my father. He's the God of my mother. He's the one my grandmother prays to. So that's who he is to you, friend. Then you're going to answer the altar call in just a minute. Who is Jesus to you? He's a distant God. He lives in the heavenlies. He never comes down and touches me. In a few minutes, he's going to touch you, friend. He's going to touch you. In a few minutes, he's going to touch you. Who is Jesus to you? Jesus, when I think of Jesus, I think of church. Oh, how I love church. We sing that song in church. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. I love Jesus. In church, we sing that song. Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Man, Easter's coming. Christ the Lord is risen today. Hallelujah. I love that song. Easter's coming. We're going to have a cantata. Jesus is going to come out of the tomb in our church. I'm going to be one of the soldiers standing around the rock. I get to fall down. Is that Jesus to you, friend? That's Jesus to about half of America. About half of America. Who is he to you, friend? I'm asking you a question. Who is he to you? Where does he fit into your life? Where is he, friend? Who is Jesus to you? Is he just some figment out there? I'm telling you tonight, he's not just a baby lying in a manger. He's a King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's everything. He's a God. He's the creator of the universe. He is everything. Oh, man. Friend, I'm losing it tonight. I've lost it too many times this week. Who is he to you? Well, if you're a preacher in this place, well, he's the theme of my messages. You know, every time I get in my study, I try to work him into it. Who is he? Oh, if it wasn't for Jesus, you wouldn't have a job. Is that what you're saying to me? If it wasn't for Jesus, you wouldn't have a ministry, because Jesus, you know, he's sort of, you know, he's on the sign of your church, you know. Jesus, the Redeemer Church, you know. So if it wasn't for Jesus, you wouldn't have a paycheck. That's who he is. He's really not that close to me, Steve. I don't really. He's not in my heart. I know that he's not in my heart, Steve. Can I be honest with you, Steve? I don't have a clue what you're talking about. What you're talking about. That's why we're here tonight, friend. That's why I'm here. I'm going to help you. I want to help you understand what it's all about. It's all about Jesus Christ, that one who's everyone worships at a distance. When this dear lady said, Jesus, that religion is hanging around the cross and Christianity is getting on the cross. See, America's hanging around the cross. And this is this right now, friend, we're living right now in the holy season, you know, between Christmas and Easter. You got your Christmas cantatas and people, boy, just when you get over that, you know, they give a little Valentine's Day gift, a little, you know, and just still sort of feeling spiritual. And here comes Easter. And everybody loves hanging around the cross. They're like the people that when the woman with the issue of blood was going after God, there was a huge crowd there. And she had to press through the crowd. She had to break through the crowd and get a hold of Jesus. But everyone else, they were fine, friend. They were fine. They were all hanging around him. But how come when she touched him, he goes, somebody touched me. Somebody touched me. That's the difference here tonight, friend. I'm talking about knowing him. Who is he to you? Is he the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? Is he everything to you? Do you wake up in the morning with Jesus on your heart? Do you go to sleep at night with Jesus on your heart? Do you eat, drink, and breathe Jesus? Does he convict you when you're alone? Or are you just convicted when you're around other people? Are you just convicted when you're around a preacher or a holy man, but at home you just do your own thing? You can sit in the back bedroom and master and just get away with it because you feel like no one's there to watch you. You're wrong, my friend. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And that should be nauseating to you to know you're being watched by God. Your body's the temple of the Holy Spirit.
Let me just say something about masturbation, kid, or mom or dad who's ever involved in this. Did you know there was a time in the United States of America, in this world, where if you were involved in masturbation, they looked at you as a lunatic. You don't believe it? You look up the history of it. There's been massive studies done on it. Only over the last few years has it become an acceptable thing, where people say, well, it's just a release of your sexual drives. But back in the olden days, it was the kind of thing that put people in asylums. They would say, he's crazy. He's insane. He's involved in that hideous act. But Jesus is watching you. Some of you squirm when we talk like this. I want to tell you, friend, mom, dad, we shoot straight at the Brownsville Revival. And maybe you're not having any problems, but we deal with the real world. We deal with some of these kids. They have to go to school, and you want to know, they not only hear about masturbation in school, they're taught about it. Not only that, then they have a film of sexual intercourse, and they discuss body parts. And you're going, don't talk to my child about masturbation. Wake up, friend. This is 1998. This is not 1932. This is not 1963. This is 1998. We're living in a nation right now where your kid, without you knowing it, can go down to the guidance counselor and say, listen, I'm pregnant, and they can work out an abortion, and you'll never know it. Your own daughter could come to you and confess 10 years from now, Mama, I had to get this out. When I was 16, I had an abortion. And you never knew it. And you can go and stomp and holler all you want at the school board. They were going, hey, we were just following the law. My daughter went in and had surgery. My daughter had a child in her womb. My daughter was 7 weeks pregnant. She came to you. You took her to a clinic. They cut the child out. They destroyed the baby, the fetus. They killed this child. And then you told my daughter she never has to tell me about it. What a world we live in. So when a preacher wants to stand up and start talking about abortion, homosexuality, masturbation, you better let them have free reign. Free reign. Free reign, friend. Because it's time. It's time for the convicting power of the Holy Spirit to come on these young people, these moms and dads, whoever it might be. It's time for the power to come down over you, friend. I haven't forgotten about you. I haven't forgotten about you. I feel them arrows. Shoo. Ha! Feel that? You feel that, don't you? You're squirming. You're squirming. Oh, my God, how long do I have to listen to this? It's not over. In a minute, Charity James is going to sing Mercy Seat. And when she sings Mercy Seat, if there's sin in your life, you're going to slip away from that couch. You're going to get on your face. And you're going to say, Jesus, I've been a homosexual. And I'm so sick of sodomy. There's a man that's caught up in little boys. Matter of fact, you're in your mid-50s. You have children of your own. And you crave little boys. In a minute, you're going to repent. You're going to get on your knees. And you're going to say, Jesus, wash this vile abomination from my life. Get it out of my thoughts. Wash me, Jesus. Come into my life. You're going to do it, friend. Oh, but I'm not that bad, Brother Steve. Little things, is it? Little things like a little lying here, a little lust there, a little pornography here. Read the word, friend. Jesus said, when you think it in your heart, you've committed it. So in just a minute, you're going to get on your face, get right with God. Your family problems, friend, all spring from the nastiness in your own heart. And if you get your heart right, if you get your heart holy, then you'll see your family start coming into line. Everybody stand. Don't move the chairs yet. Don't move them yet. Here's what we're going to do. I want everyone to hear this before anybody moves their chairs. This is a night. It's a night of power. It's a night of deliverance. It's a night of salvation. It's a night of healing. Whatever you need. See, here at this revival, we lift up Jesus. If I turned to David Ravenhill a few minutes ago and I said, after Daniel's testimony, I said, you know, if people came in here and they can't believe that, here a principal takes the guy's switchblade away and says, I dare you to go to Brownsville. He didn't say, I dare you to go to church. He said, I dare you to go to that revival. Why? The principal knows what's going on behind these doors. I promise you, the principal has seen too many changed lives. He knows if he can direct this man to that place, he'll hear something like you heard tonight. And Daniel won't be walking around with a switchblade, and he won't be doing drugs no more. Principal knew that. Daniel comes in, he hears about Jesus. That's the only one we lift up. If you want us to lift up church and religion and denominations, you're in the wrong place. We only lift up Jesus here. He's a healer of our souls. He's a deliverer. He's the one that set us free. Here's what you're going to have to do tonight. You're going to have to come down here to this altar. Those of you that have sin in your life, anything between you and God, you're going to have to break away. Publicly. Now here, unlike massive crusades that are held around the world, we don't have people close their eyes and raise their hands. We just don't do that. I want to tell you why. If you do that at your church, pastor, that's your business. That's your cup of tea. But when I saw a vision of Jesus, when I studied the scripture, and I saw the way he died, it wasn't all eyes closed, hands lifted up. Jesus was beaten publicly. Matter of fact, I believe he was blindfolded at one time. Is that correct? He was beaten with a rod. Yeah, they said, who hit you? They crowned him with the thorns, beat him over the head, whipped him from the nape of his neck to his buttocks. They ripped his back to shreds with little pieces of bone and glass tied to leather. Raked it down his back. The psalmist talks about the plowers, isn't it? The plowers plowed upon my back. Then they took him, slapped a beam on his back, and told him to drag it up to yonder hill. There weren't no eyes closed. It was all public. Jesus was already half dead. And he took the cross up to Calvary's hill. And on the way up there, some people were weeping. And he said, oh, don't weep for me. You have no clue what this is all about. What's coming? What's coming is what you need to weep about. And he gets up to Calvary. And if that wasn't bad enough, what he'd already been through, let the man die. No, they strip him. Roman crucifixion was naked, nude. That picture you got hanging in your church is just so people can look on the crucifixion. That little loincloth. The crucifixion, Roman crucifixion was naked. And friend, most all the commentators, most all the theologians agree. And most of the ones that don't agree don't want to face it. They can't imagine God naked. So they slapped him on the cross, pierced his hands, pierced his feet. Through the beam in the hole, Jesus is standing there naked in front of mankind. The women that he had led to himself, the women, Mary, Martha, his mom, the women who had hung around him, the women, the disciples, were staring from afar at this naked Jesus. I want you to think about it, for I don't know what you believe in. When he said from that cross, See, he went through everything anybody could ever go through. You ever been humiliated? Maybe in front of a class? Maybe something happened, somebody did something and humiliated you? Next time that happens, if you're in front of 1,000 people and you're humiliated, just stop for just a minute. Say everybody's laughing at you. Just stop for a minute, close your eyes, and look at the Calvary. And look at that cross and see Jesus hanging naked. And then open your eyes and say, my Lord and my God, this is nothing. Humiliation, this is nothing. Then from the cross, he says, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. I hope somebody's listening tonight, friend. I don't know who he is to you. I don't know who he is. But every jot and tittle of the Word of God is true. When he hung in his head and died, he made a beeline to hell, walked up to Lucifer, and said, hand him over. Give me the keys. He snatched the keys. Death, hell, and the grave. He paid the ultimate sacrifice for sin. Lucifer had no hold on anybody again. He rose from the dead. And if you read the crucifixion story, when he died, friend, rocks split open. Earthquake. The Bible even says, I'm talking to you, friend, what do you believe? The Bible says that everyone who were beholding him began to beat their breast. One centurion said, surely this was the Son of God. But you know what this means? This is a sign of contrition and guiltiness. People were going like this, my God. But they weren't only doing this, friend. The earth was shaking. They were going. And they ran to their homes, I promise you. Get as far away from they can from that scene. And around the dinner table, what was it like? Honey, where were you today? Baby, the ground that I was standing on split open. Baby, I ran, and as I ran, boulders, honey, 5 feet thick, split open in front of my very eyes. And I ran by the graveyard, honey, and tombs came open. People were rising from the dead. Who was the man in the middle? Who was that man on that cross today? That's why I believe, friend, just a few days later on the day of Pentecost, when Peter says, the man who you crucified. I believe some of them were out there going, if they weren't there personally, they had heard about it. And that's why they said, what must we do to be saved? And that's what's happening in America again, friend. The power's coming down. Conviction is hitting people. People are going, what must I do? I've played religion all my life. I've been in church for years, but I don't know him. What must I do? What have I got to do to get right with God? I want this sin out of my life. I want to be holy. I want the smile of God on me. I want the favor of God. What must I do? What must I do? Well, I'm glad you asked. Because here's what you're going to do. If there's something in your life between you and God, if you don't know Jesus, you're going to hit this altar so quick, friend. You're going to get right with God. You're going to run from the balcony. You're going to come down those stairs so quick. You're going to skip 2 and 3 stairs at a time. You're going to come down here, friend. You're going to race to these altars, and you're going to say, Jesus, I want to get right with you. Because tonight ain't no ordinary night. Tonight, Jesus, I'm telling you, I believe in you. I believe in you. And I'm not only going to say I believe in you, I'm going to act my belief in you. I'm going to live for you. I'm going to get right with you tonight, Jesus. I'm going to pour out my heart to you, Jesus. I'm getting right with God. And these preachers at this Congress would say, amen. And Jonathan Edwards would say, preach it. Move the chairs. Charity, come on. Everyone remain standing. You know what Peter Marshall would say? Something like this. I've prayed and I've prayed. Now, 50 years later, I believe some of the prayers of Peter Marshall are being answered. See, there's people that have prayed for years for you, friend. Grandmas and grandpas prayed for what we're seeing right now. What you're about to see at these altars, there's been people that have wept and wailed before God for years. Look this way, folks. There's been people that have wailed before God, poured out their hearts to God. Send revival, send revival. And back in 1979, Grandma, as she was praying maybe, had a heart attack and died, and you buried her. And now, her prayers are being answered. Her prayers are being answered. God has sent revival. I'll tell you something else. In this place, everyone pay attention. I'm waiting for them to move these chairs. You ain't got a whole lot of time. Hear me and hear me good. If you had the research that we have on the mark of the beast, you would stay on your face before God 24 hours a day. If you just knew what we knew about the mark of the beast, we stay on top of it, friend. Everything's just about ready. It is so close, it's scary. Wesley couldn't talk like this. At Azusa Street, they couldn't preach like this. They preached, but they didn't have the technology back then. Some of it was still fuzzy. Nothing's fuzzy anymore. Nothing's fuzzy. It's just, you go, yeah, yeah. You can talk about the mark of the beast with an economist, a secular banker. He go, oh, yeah, yeah, that in Revelation. Yeah, shoot. Are you kidding? We're just waiting for the public to accept it. We've got that, man. We're just so sick and tired of paper. Sick and tired of credit cards. We're so sick and tired of all this system set up like this. It's wasting taxpayers' money. What we need to do is have this lightning system. We had 50 people going to India right now. You go to India in 20, 30 years, friend, you'll go with a mark. You get on that plane. No more showing your driver's license. That's so archaic. You get on the plane, you just wave your hand across a wand, a little star. Your whole identification shows up on a screen. DNA, everything. You get to India, no problem in restaurants. You don't have to get no Indian money. You don't have to trade over your money from the United States. That's old. That's archaic. They did that back in the 90s, back in the last millennium. Now what do? You want money? What do you want, a Coke? Wave your hand over the Indian Coke machine. Out comes a Coke if you got that money in your account back home. If you ain't got the money in your account back home, you don't get a Coke. Right. Folks, the technology's already here. It's already here. They're just waiting on us. Waiting on the right person to rise up and say, this is the way we got to go or it's not going to work. Nothing's going to work anymore. Friend, you're going to get right with God. You better get right with God now. And stay right with God. And stay right with God. Everyone in this place that's backslidden, that means at one time you knew the Lord. Come on, brother, go ahead. At one time you knew the Lord. If you're away from God, Charity, go ahead and sing it. If you need Jesus, if you need forgiveness, come on right now. Don't let anything stop you. If you need forgiveness, hurry, 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 hurry. In the balcony, let's go. Come on, come on, come on. Hurry, hurry, hurry. Get on your face before the Lord. Let's go. Come on, come on, come on. In the balcony, let's go. Come on, God bless you. Sit down. Come on. Kneel down, kneel down. Come on.
I can find a
hurry.
Way to heal.
Hurry. 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 What are you waiting on? Let's go.
He said that I could come into his presence without fear, and to the holy place where his mercy hovers near.
Hold it, Charity. Hold it. Everyone at the altar, stay where you're at. That was called the first wave. That was the first wave. Everyone at the altar, bow your heads. Team, come on up and join me up here. This is the first wave. Second wave is about to come. You're in the second wave, friend. If there's sin in your life, if you're religious and you don't know Jesus, you're going to come. I'm going to say that again. You can be a church member. You can go to hell with baptismal waters on your face, friend. You can go to hell with a choir robe on. You can go to hell with a certificate of ordination hanging on behind your desk. You can go to hell. This is just the first wave. This was immediate conviction. This was all over these people. But now what? What about you? Do you know Jesus? Have you ever known him? I'm telling you, friend, any little sin can separate you from God. Everyone at the altar, keep your heads down and don't move. Any little sin can separate you from God. Here's what I'm going to do. This is the second wave. You watch what's going to happen. In the balcony, down here, I'm going to do something that the Lord has instructed me to do over the last few days. I'm going to bind Satan from your life. And when I do this, when I bind him, when I bind Satan, see, Satan's got that hold on you. Satan will grip you with pride. You'll say, I can't go down there. I'm too proud. Friend, when I bind him, the shackle's going to come loose from you. It's going to come loose, and you have, listen, folks, you have a few seconds to step out. If you don't step out, you're saying you might as well turn to the devil and say, you've got me, Satan, you can have me. You've got me in my sin, because the devil knows what's going on inside your life, friend. He knows what's going on. He knows the sin. I'm going to bind Lucifer right now, and if there's sin in your life, you've got a split second to slip out. Are you ready? As soon as I begin praying, you better get out and come quickly. You ready? Satan, in Jesus' name, I bind you. I bind you. I bind you. I bind you from her life. I bind you from his life. Now, come on, hurry. 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 Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. I'm going to close. Everyone at the altar, keep your heads down. Boy, I can feel this up here, friend. But I want to tell you, this is going to be the third wave. The third wave is this. And for those of you that think I say this every night, this is the first time I've said this in the revival. This is the very first time in almost three solid years. But that was the first wave of repentance. This was the second wave. The third wave is this. Everyone's going to turn to the person next to them, and you're going to ask them if they need forgiveness. Wait a minute. Don't do it. You're going to ask them if they need Jesus to forgive them. When somebody turns to you and asks you that question, you can be turning to a total stranger. Friends, look at me, folks. Everyone at the altar, keep your heads down. When we have done this, we've had some of the most incredible salvations take place right now. First-time conversions when someone turned to somebody. But if somebody turns to you and says, do you need Jesus to forgive you? And there's sin in your life, and you say no, you're not saying no to the preacher. You're saying, no, 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 God, I'm keeping my sin. Remember that. But if you'll turn to that person and say, yeah, there's something between me and God, and then both of you slip out together, Jesus will take it away. Everyone turn to the person next to them and ask them if they need forgiveness. Right now, then both of you come down together. Hurry, 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 hurry. Yes, God bless you. Come on, come on. Everyone at the altar, bow your heads. If you haven't come by now, friend, if you haven't come by now, something's seriously wrong. Matter of fact, I'm going to give you 15 seconds. 14, 13, 12, God bless you. 11, 10, God bless you. 9, 8, God bless you, God bless you, God bless this couple. God bless you, sir. Man, we got 20 people right over there coming. Come on. Come on. Come on down from the balcony. Folks, I'm telling you, it's time to get right with God. 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 Everyone at the altar, keep your heads down. God's washing. He's cleansing. He's making you new. Come on, sir. Come on. Come on. Come on. Forgive us, friend, but the door is still open. It's still open. I can't stop. It's called mercy. Mercy. Somebody's praying for you, friend. Come on. Come on. Hurry, 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 hurry. Hurry. Got a drummer back there? I want you to drum. You got a watch? Give the man a watch with a second hand on it. Got one? Got a second hand on it? I want you to knock off seconds, 60 seconds. One at a time. Just... 57. 54. Hurry. God bless you. God bless you. Hurry. 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 Come on. God bless you, sir. We're closing. We're closing. Hurry. 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 In the balcony. Let's go. Come on. Listen. Ticking away. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Hurry. Hurry. A few seconds left. Come on down. Come on. Hurry. Look at this. Come on. Come on. Let them through. Let them through. God bless you, kids. God bless you, kids. Get on your knees. Shoot. Everyone at the altar, bow your heads. We're going to pray with these folks, but I want to tell you, if you're here and you have not come down, before this service is out, I want you to tell one of our prayer meeting, our prayer workers, before this meeting's out, tell one of our prayer workers, you disobeyed God. You tell one of our prayer workers you disobeyed God and you want them to pray with you. Everyone at this altar, bow your heads. Pray with me out loud. Loud, don't mumble. Dear Jesus, thank you for speaking to me. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for not leaving me alone. Thank you for your arrows. You've hit the bullseye. I need you, Jesus. I need forgiveness. I have sinned. I have hurt you. I've hurt myself. I've hurt others. Forgive me, Jesus. Wash me. Cleanse me. I ask you tonight to be my Savior. Be my Lord. My very best friend. From this moment on, I am yours and you are mine. Come live your life through me. And Jesus, I promise I will not be religious. I will not hang around the cross. I will get on the cross. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. In the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Glory.